All right, very good morning, everyone, and welcome to Gospel Light Christian Church, our first Good Friday worship service, English worship service this morning. Wishing everyone a blessed Good Friday, and we thank God for the opportunity that we can gather together to remember Christ. Shall we arise this morning, and let's greet one another this morning? And a very warm welcome to those who are with us for the first time. Thank you for coming to worship with us. Alright, so let's join our hearts together in prayer as we begin. Let us pray together. Come, let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this time where we can get to worship you together. Together in this manner, in this place, to remember again about your great sacrifice on the cross. Lord, indeed, thank you that Good Friday is not just another holiday for us, but rather it is a time for us who believe in you to remember what you've done for us. The great love and mercy shown to us on the cross. The love that covers our debt of sin. The blood that was shed for us. So Lord, during this time we pray that Spirit of the Living God, you will work in our hearts to draw us closer to you. We pray for those who are coming for the first time as well, that this service will be a blessing to them and that they will be able to hear the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So Lord, as we sing the songs, as we worship you, as we pray and as we listen to the preaching of your word, may all these things help us point towards you. So Lord, continue to guide us this morning, we pray. And bless this time, Lord, for your honor and your glory. And we ask now in Jesus' name together, amen. Right, this morning we gather to remember Christ and the cross. Let's remember the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, who was sacrificed on the old rugged cross.
To the old rugged cross.
The word says, "For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." This morning, let's remember the power of the cross that saves us. Oh, to see the dawn. Let's sing.
Oh, to see the dawn of the darkest day, Christ on the road to Calvary, tried by sinful men, torn and beaten there, nailed to a cross of wood.
This is the power.
And this the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the pain, bore the wrath we sent, forgiven at the cross.
See the pain. Let's sing.
To see my name written.
As we continue in worship, in Gospel Light, we regularly read our catechism during the services to go through the truths we believe in. So let's read today's catechism together. I will read the question and we will all read the answer together. So the question is, what is the gospel? Together, the gospel is the good news of Jesus Christ dying on the cross and rising from the grave to save man from his sins in order to reconcile sinful men to the holy God. Jesus died on the cross to save us from sin, death, and hell. He came to redeem us and call us his own. Let's praise him with this last song we'll sing together, Is He Worthy? And we sung this online during the COVID period. We had it during one of the Good Friday services as well. If you know the song, please join in. If you don't, then just listen to the lyrics, just meditate on the words. And you'll be seeing some lyrics where they'll be in brackets. Usually this is sung by the leader, so I'll just sing this and then you respond. And if you see the normal words, then just feel free to sing along as well. So indeed, the Lamb of God is worthy of all praise. So let's sing this song together.
Thank you.
is he worthy of this? He is.
Pastor Paul, to come up to welcome everyone.
Good morning, everyone. On behalf of Gospel Light, we'd like to welcome all of you for this very special service, especially our first-time visitors, friends, relatives who are joining us. Today is a very special day. Every Sunday is special, but today we commemorate, we celebrate what is the greatest event in human history, the greatest demonstration of love ever, the greatest sacrifice ever, the greatest gift ever. It's this wonderful day has changed our lives for many of us, and we are thankful that we can share this with all of you, and we pray that it will change many, many lives. So on behalf of the church, once again, welcome, especially for the newcomers. Now, if you are here for the very first time, we hope that you'll stay back with us, join us for kind of light refreshments after this service is over. We have a little corner called the Newcomers Corner, and just come, just meet us, say hi, you know. And if you are a newcomer, kindly raise your hand so we can pass you some welcome packs. All right, we're not going to do anything more than that, just pass you a welcome pack so you get to know our church a little better. All right, yeah, some of you who are newcomers. Today we expect quite a number of newcomers because it's a special day. So kindly just raise your hand, get a little pack, get to know us a little better. Stay back for coffee and some snacks and get to know us a little better. Thank you for raising your hand, and we hope those of you who didn't raise your hand will still join us at the Newcomers Corner. Now at this point of our worship service, we worship God by giving. Right, and please, for those who are not believers, don't feel obliged at all to give. Right, we only want those who are believers who have enjoyed the wonderful things that God has given to us, especially at the cross, and we want to demonstrate our love by giving to Him. Right, so at this time we all worship God by our offerings. Right, so please, no obligation for anyone, believer or unbeliever. God bless you.
Thank you. they stripped him, and twisting together a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and put a reed in his right hand. And kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and led him away to crucify him. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." From the sixth hour, there was darkness over all the land. Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" About the ninth hour, Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. And behold, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth shook and the rocks were split. His body was placed in a tomb cut out of the rock. At dawn on Sunday, the women went to see the tomb. An angel of the Lord had descended from heaven and rolled back the stone. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen."
All right. Let's move on to our sermon scripture reading for today, and this is taken from Luke 23, verses 32 to 43. I will read for you, and let's imagine and remember the scene of Calvary. So Luke 23, verse 32. "Two others, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with him. And when they came to the place that is called the Skull, there they crucified him, and the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. And Jesus said, 'Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.' And they cast lots to divide his garments. And the people stood by, watching. But the rulers scoffed at him, saying, 'He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is the Christ of God, his chosen one.' The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, 'If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself.' There was also an inscription over him, 'This is the King of the Jews.' One of the criminals who were hanged railed at him, saying, 'Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us.' But the other rebuked him, saying, 'Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong.' And he said, 'Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.' And verse 43, and he said to him, 'Truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise.'" God bless the reading of his word.
Invite all of you, please, to arise. Let's unite our hearts as we come to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day we can remember, an event that has changed many of our lives. Not change it for a while, not change it for a moment in time in this world, but change our lives from a hopeless end to an endless hope. Lord, many of us can testify to this amazing life-changing event that happened 2,000 years ago. Lord, today as we stand, we want to commemorate. We want to remember. We want to celebrate this amazing event that the Son of God, Creator of the world, came to this world in human form to go with one mission to the cross, to go with this mission to take our sins, all our sins, past sins, present sins, even our future sins. Only He, as God, knew what we would commit 2,000 years ago. He took every sin and carried the weight of sin on that cross and hung on that cross and paid a penalty we can never understand. All the movies, all the attempts, and even the preachers attempt probably today to explain how one Savior could carry the sin of the world and bear the penalty that we should have carried for eternity. And He took it all, and in those few agonizing hours, He paid the full penalty, and He cried out, "It is finished. The penalty is paid." And we know He proved it 3 days later. Lord, we come today not ever able to understand this transaction, not able to understand the depth of sin we are in, the millions and billions of sins that we have committed with our eyes, our ears, our tongue, our heart, our actions. But Lord, we know He took it all. And Lord, the suffering we can never understand. But Lord, today we come with all our limitations to say thank you, God. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for doing this amazing transaction for us. And we just pray, God, today that everyone who's here, who have not yet understood this, who have not yet known this amazing act and this amazing gift, will leave today and say, thank you, God. Lord, we know, I know, personally myself, I feared death. As a doctor, I saw people fearing death over and over again. And today, I can stand before my God and say, thank you, God. Thank you for Jesus Christ, who settled my debt for me. I'm ready to face my Creator and my Judge, not because of who I am, but because of what He did for me. So God, today, on this day, we plead with you that everyone here would return home with the greatest gift of all, the gift of God's love in Jesus Christ at the cross. So God, we just thank you so much for this day, and we commit our preacher, Yufei, to your loving hands, that you use him with his limited words, this limited time, to articulate by the grace of your Holy Spirit this amazing truth to all of us. Prepare our hearts, God. We commit this time to your loving hands, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. Now, for those who are new, today is not our usual preacher. Our usual preacher, Pastor Jason, is preaching at another church. Some of you may know, Covenant Evangelical Free Church. He's preaching there. Today, we have a younger generation of preachers, Pastor Yufei, the next generation. We are just thankful for all the young preachers God has raised for us. And we just believe that God will use him in a wonderful way today. Pastor Yufei, please.
Good morning, church. Welcome to our Good Friday service. And this is the day where thousands and millions of Christians gather together to celebrate and commemorate the death and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. And if you're new with us, I want to encourage you, like what Pastor Paul mentioned, do stay back to have a chat. Do stay back, especially to find out more about Christianity, because that is what we believe in, and that's what I want to share with you this morning. And I believe that you're here not by chance. I believe that God has a word for you this morning that you can receive, and He wants to change your life. Now, just a short introduction of myself again. This is my family, my beloved wife, and my little boy, Elliot, who's going to turn 18 months. And it's there's a recurring joke that every time when I come to the pulpit, to the main service, when I come to preach, my season of life changes, my stage of life changes. The first time I came, I was a single man. The second time I came here, I was attached. Then I got engaged. Then I got married. Then I have a kid. And today I want to announce to you that I'm going to have another kid, a baby girl that's going to come in late May or early June. So do keep my family in prayer. Hopefully the next time I come, I don't think I'll be a grandparent anytime. I don't think I have time to have the third kid, but nevertheless, do keep my family in prayer. You know, today we want to look at the Bible. Today is Good Friday period, right? Where we want to look at the Bible and we want to look at the cross, where not just about the life of Jesus, we want to look through the lens of a thief that repented and came to faith because of what Jesus Christ have done on the cross. That's where he began to understand who Jesus was, who this Messiah was, and he put his faith and trust in Jesus Christ. His life was changed. But interestingly, this thief on the cross, beside Jesus, right at the start, both of the thieves were mocking Jesus. But at the end of the day, before he died, before he was hung on the cross, the thief as well, he made a decision to follow Jesus, and he made a decision to cry out for mercy and ask Jesus to come and save him. One that was mocking Jesus to one that was asking for mercy. And that's what we want to hear from today's story. Through the lens of that thief, what happened? How did he came to faith? And it's a similar story of how you and I came to faith, comes to faith as well. But before that Good Friday, before that Friday where Jesus died on the cross to save us from our sin, on that very night, the night before, Jesus was betrayed by Judas. He was beaten up by the Jewish leader, slapped on the face, spit at Jesus, accused him to be the Messiah, and he accused him, and he was just mocked by the Jewish leader. And the Jewish leader have been plotting the death of Jesus Christ for very long. They wanted to kill Jesus, but they could not do that, so they sent Jesus to the Pontius Pilate, the governing body during that period, to sentence Jesus to death. There, Jesus was at the hands of Pontius Pilate. Pontius Pilate had to set someone free. But either Barabbas, a murderer, a evildoer, a criminal, and he asked the crowd, the Jewish leader and the people there, who will you want to set free? Barabbas, the guy that you all hated, the guy that murdered people, or this innocent man, Jesus, who will you want to set free? And there, everyone cry out, crucify him, crucify him, crucify Jesus. And they just wanted the death of Jesus Christ. The Roman governor, Pontius Pilate, decided, you know what? In order to please the crowd, not to create a riot, he set Barabbas free and sent Jesus to the cross. And there Jesus was scourged. There Jesus was beaten. There Jesus was being tortured by the Roman soldiers, by the cats of nine tails. His flesh was pulled out. The Bible tells us his face was more marked than any man, disfigured. And these are just imagery of a guy of the Passion of Christ that created this. And these pictures are nothing as compared to what Jesus had gone through 2,000 over years ago. There, they mocked Jesus. There, Jesus was being led to the cross. There, Jesus had a crown of thorns and a purple robe around him to mock him as the king. He's not really the king. He is the one that's going to be crucified on the cross. And there, Jesus, his hands and his feet was nailed on the cross, and he hung there to die for the sins of the whole wide world. You see, this is the story of Good Friday, how Jesus came to die for your sins and my sin. And when he was hanged on the cross, there was two thieves beside him. One of the thief repented, the other thief continued to mock Jesus. You see, the Bible tells us two others who were criminals were led to be put to death, to be crucified with Jesus. These are evildoers. These are people that deserve that capital punishment, that crucifixion. These are people that probably rebel against the authority, either murderer or thief, and they just are wicked people, destroying the life of people. And there, as compared to Jesus, that innocent man in the middle of the cross, in the middle of the tree cross, there was Jesus being innocent. And they came to a place that's called Skull or Calvary, and they crucified Jesus and the criminals, one on the left and one on their right. That crucifixion took place outside of the city of the Roman Empire, outside of the city. It's a place where there will be lots of people that were going out and in to the city. And it's a place where they will draw most crowd. It is a place where Jesus and the people that will be going to be crucified there will be full of shame. This is the place to deter people from committing such crime. And there, this is the scene that I want to paint to you guys. And I want to bring you through the lens of one of the thieves that repented. What's this thief? This thief saw the contempt of the crowd. One of the thieves saw how the people mock Jesus, ridiculing Jesus, scoff at Jesus. That thief on the cross saw the rulers scoff at him. And the thief on the cross saw that not just the rulers was scoffing at thief. He heard the word of the rulers, the Jewish leader. He saved others. Let him save himself. This Jesus, whom you call Messiah, he can save others. He can heal the sick. He can raise the dead. He can cause the blind to see. He has done many, many miracles. He has saved so many people, so-called, but he can't even save himself. They were mocking Jesus. He saw that in the lens of the thief, he saw the soldiers mocking him, offering sour wine to prolong his death. If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself, you so-called king. And they mock and they laugh at Jesus. And there was an inscription over him, "This is the king of the Jews," trying to mock Jesus. And there, the passerby that were passing through the main gates of Jerusalem, of the city then, And they saw Jesus and the thief, and they were just mocking him, derailing him, wagging their heads and saying, "These people, this Jesus, whom in the past he says, you will destroy the temple and rebuild in 3 days, save yourself, come down from the cross." And they were mocking Jesus. And not just the crowd. The very thief that were hung on the cross together with Jesus, both of them, the Bible tells us in Matthew and in Mark, they were also at the same time mocking Jesus, reviling him. And those who were crucified with him also reviled him. So you see, everyone was mocking Jesus. Have you ever wondered why? Because they have a wrong expectation of Jesus. Their kind of Messiah, the Savior, is not the kind that Jesus portrayed. For the Jewish leader, they thought that the Messiah will come and rule and reign. There's going to come and establish an earthly kingdom for them. And all the Jewish people will rule and reign with Christ. But Jesus did not come and rule and reign during then. This Jesus was a suffering king. This Jesus was beaten. They cannot accept, they cannot acknowledge that this is the Messiah, because they have a wrong understanding of who the Messiah is. The passerby were just mocking because it's part of their culture. Then they do not know who Jesus is, so they join in and mock Jesus. Even the thief was mocking Jesus. I don't know about you, but do you know who the Messiah is? Do you know who Jesus is in your life? I remember before I became a Christian, I was one that was like the thief on the cross. I was once like the rulers and the soldiers and the passerby. I was mocking Jesus. I was laughing at those Christians. You know, I strongly believe before I was a Christian, I laughed at these Christians and said, why do these Christians have to cling on to a false hope to give them some shock feelings? Why do these Christians have to go to church every Sunday to worship this person whom they cannot even see? And they will give money and they will do a lot of things for this person whom I don't even believe exists. I was mocking, I was ridiculing, I was laughing at my Christian friends. Maybe that is you this morning. That was you maybe 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 20 over years ago. Maybe you were the one that was mocking Jesus because you don't understand who Jesus is. So in through the lens of the thief, they cannot understand who Jesus, they don't understand who Jesus was, right? They saw the contempt of the crowd. But at the very same time, the thief saw the compassion of Jesus. He saw how Jesus responded to their mockery. He saw how Jesus chose to say certain things. He saw how Jesus treated them. He hears the words of Jesus on the cross. He saw the compassion of Jesus. And this is what he hears. He hears that Jesus replying to the people and praying to the Father, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." The very thief on the cross was mocking Jesus and hear how Jesus responded to them, he realized that this Jesus is different. This Jesus has the power to ask the Father to forgive sin. High chance this thief is probably a Jew. And as a Jew, they understood that no one can forgive sin except God himself. And he began to comprehend, who is this Jesus that asking the Father to forgive them for their sins, for their wrongdoings? The Roman soldier, the Jewish leader that plotted against Jesus, that beat, scorned, ridiculed, slapped, spat on, do all kinds of evil things to Jesus. And Jesus said this, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." That is where, in the lens of the thief, he began to comprehend slightly more who this so-called Messiah is. He began to comprehend the love of Jesus Christ to those who wronged him. He began to realize that this Jesus has a certain authority that no one ever had. He began to realize that this Messiah, whom they have been, for the Jewish people, they have been looking forward to this Messiah, and maybe this Jesus is the Messiah that they all have been looking forward to. He saw the compassion of Jesus Christ. I don't know about you, but if you are mocked, if you are ridiculed, if you are being misunderstood by your bosses, by your friends, by your loved ones, and if you are being, not just in words, being misunderstood, you are beaten, and what will you do? Most of the time, how we will respond to people that wrong us is we will fight back. We will do whatever we can to get back to them. But that's not the response of Jesus. Jesus chose to ask the Father to forgive them. There at the cross, that thief began to comprehend who this Jesus is. Then we see the conversion of this thief. That's where we see that everything from the thief was mocking Jesus to one that began to understand who this Jesus is. Then that's where he has this conversion. That's where he cried out for mercy from one that mocked to one that asked Jesus for mercy. One of the thief who was on the cross read at Jesus, "Aren't you the Christ, the chosen one? Aren't you the one that is going to come and save us? Save yourself and us." That thief, the other thief, was so concerned about here and now. But the other thief, that thief that repented, rebuked this other thief. What changed? Remember, these two thieves were mocking Jesus at the start. And now, at the end, near the end, this thief has a change of heart. This thief has a change of perspective. This change, this thief have a change of an understanding of who Jesus is. And he began to rebuke that very guy on beside Jesus. He said, do you not fear God since you are under the same condemnation? And indeed, we justly, we are receiving the due rewards of our deed. We deserve it because we are evildoers. But these men have done nothing wrong. And we want to look at how this thief came to faith, how this thief came to ask Jesus for mercy. First, this thief realized something. This thief realized that he was a sinner, and this sinner that he's going to face some form of condemnation. He rebuked the thief, says, do you not fear God since you are under the same condemnation? In a very loose way, he's saying to the other thief, do you not fear God whom you're not just going to die being crucified? You're going to face God one day. After you die, you're going to face God. Don't you fear God? Don't you fear what he can do to your soul? That repentant thief, realized that they are not just going to be sentenced to death by crucifixion. This thief understood something deeper, where their souls will be going after they die. Do you not fear God since you're under the same condemnation? In a paraphrase way, look, the other thief, we are getting exactly what we deserve. Don't you have a fear of what's going on, what's going to happen to you when we face God's judgment when we die? Don't you realize that? There he realized that he was a sinner, and there he realized that sin, the sin that he has ever committed ever in his life, all the sins that he has ever committed in his life, is going to have a consequence. There he realized that he was a sinner. And not just he realized that he was a sinner, he recognized something. He recognized that this Jesus is innocent. He recognized that this Jesus have done nothing wrong. He recognized that Jesus was perfect, was sinless. All the accusation that people have done to him is all fake news. There he realized that Jesus was innocent. And there he realized that Jesus was not just innocent. Jesus probably, high chance, is the coming Messiah that's going to come and take the sins of the world. So you see, for the Jewish people, they have been taught about through the Passover lamb, through all the laws in the Bible, all the festival in the Bible, and if you have been Pastor Jason's sermon in the last few weeks through the book of Leviticus, you will realize that the Jewish people have to go through a lot of rituals and duties festival to for us to remember that these are just the foreshadow of Christ, the foreshadow of the Messiah that is going to come. And there on that cross, this thief realized that probably this Jesus that was hung beside him is that Messiah that's going to come and take the sins of the world. There he realized that this Jesus is the Messiah. There he realized that this Jesus is able to forgive sin and he's the one that's going to take the sins of the entire world. There he realized that Jesus was not just an innocent man, the perfect sinless man. There he realized that this Jesus is the Savior of the world. Then you see that this thief repent. He changed of his mind, right? One that mocked Jesus at the start have a change of mind. What's repentant? Repentant means a change of mind. This thief have a change of mind. He realized that I was a sinner. He realized that my sin has to be dealt with. And he realized this Jesus was that Messiah that all along the people were waiting for. And he turned away from his own personal belief and he turned to Jesus for salvation. There he repents. And he cried out to Jesus, Jesus, remember me. I know that now you are the Messiah, you are the Savior. Remember me when you come into your kingdom. You know, for the Jewish people, they all have been taught since young that there will come a Messiah that's going to come and rule and reign with them. That this Messiah is going to come and establish an earthly kingdom on earth with God's people, and they will rule and reign with him. And there he realized that this is the Messiah, And not just that, he asked Jesus, Jesus, when you come into your kingdom, can you remember me? Can you accept me into your kingdom when you come and establish in the near future? There he realized that this Jesus is the Messiah. And you know what he did? Let me ask you this question. What he did was amazing, because what he did was a pure understanding of who Jesus was and a plea out of the mercy and the grace and the compassion of God. And he cried out, please remember me. Remember the thief? He was an evildoer. He sinned the best that he knows how. He lived his life for himself and not for others and not for God's kingdom. And he do whatever he wants in his life. And now, by the way, he deserved to be hanged on the cross, right? Because of his evil deeds. But now, he realized, even though he's a sinful man, he cried for mercy. God, have mercy on me. Is it anything that he has done that he deserved this to ask Jesus to remember him when he comes to his kingdom? No, it's not because of whether he's a good person, not because he has done something good in his life or he's a proper person. No, he was a sinner. And he asked Jesus for mercy. There he repented. And this is the most beautiful part. Jesus replied him, truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. In other words, hey, you are looking for that future establishment of the earthly kingdom. Now I tell you, you don't need to wait for the future. Today, you will be with me. You will be with me in heaven. You will have salvation. You will be rescued. And that's what Jesus said. Isn't that amazing? And how we see the conversion of this thief, one that was mocking to one that asked Jesus for mercy, and how Jesus accepted him and rescued him and gave him salvation. That is the story of the thief. That's the story of how God was gracious towards this thief and how this thief came to faith. Maybe you ask, so what does it have to do with us today? This is the story of the thief, but let me tell you something. This is the story of many of us. For Christians here, this is our story, isn't it? We realize that we don't deserve any of God's mercy and grace. But we understood that God is a God of grace. God is a God of mercy. He died on the cross for us. And not because we are good, but because He is good. And we put our faith in Jesus Christ. And He rescued us. As simple as that. But I want to share with the people here that may be hearing the gospel for the first time. As the thief realized that he was a sinner, you today need to realize that you are a sinner. And not just that you are a sinner, the sins that you've ever committed in your life, in the past, even this morning, your sins have to be dealt with. The Bible tells us, for the wages of sin is death. When you sin, there is a payment, there is a wages, and these wages of sin, the Bible tells us, is death. This is not the first death that you are thinking about, because all of us here, we will have to die one day. Just like the thief on the cross, when they are hung on the cross, they will be crucified. They will die. But that thief understood that there is more than life beyond what we have on earth. He realized that he has to answer to God for his soul, for the things that he has ever done. This death is not referring to the death that we all face. This death is referring to the second death, where your soul is going to go, where your soul is going to go when you die, is either heaven or eternal lake of punishment, hell. Because the Bible tells us in Revelation, but as for the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, as for the murderers, the sexually immoral, the sorcerers, the idolaters, and all liars, their portions will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. This is the part where when you die, where your souls will go is either heaven or hell that's going to be punished by fire and brimstone. That's where you are going to be separated from God for all eternity. This is a serious matter, because the thief understood that he was in deep trouble because of his sin. You need to realize that we are all sinners, and that sins that you ever committed need to be paid. Either you paid You pay your sin in hell, or either you pay your sin by the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, many years ago, this is me, look like Elliot, but this is really me. I don't really have a very good childhood. And I don't really have a very good, I don't grow up in church, by the way. I grew up in a Buddhist, Taoist family. And I have no concept that I am a sinner. I have no concept that I need to be saved. I live my life the way that I want. I don't care. That's why I laugh at Christians, right? All these stupid Christians. Okay, I mean, during that time, why do they need to go to church? Why do they need to go to ask Jesus to save them? I don't need saving. I don't care. But it was one of the nights where I was attending a church. I was invited by my friend to a barbecue event. It's a scam. They come ask me to go barbecue, but they come and share the gospel to me. There, I began to, first time I hear the name of Jesus, there I realized that this Jesus loves me. This Jesus tells me that I'm a sinner. And I want to find out more about this Christianity. So I attended the church for another 3 months, pretending to be a Christian, but actually I am not. Deep in my heart, I know that I wasn't a Christian. But it was one night during a youth camp sermon. The preacher was talking about the severity of my sin and the consequence of my sin. The preacher talks about for the wages of sin is death. The preacher talks about I am a sinner and I need a savior. That was where I began to realize that how sinful I was and how I need to be saved from my wickedness. You know, I don't come from a well-to-do background, broken family. My parents, my dad passed away when I was very, very young. My mom passed away when I was 13 years old. And my mom got remarried. And at the age of, I was with my stepfather until my mom passed away when I was 13. And my stepfather kicked me out of the house when I was 15, 16 years old, when I was secondary school or early poly days. I don't really have good upbringing. No one taught me how to live my life. I live the life that I want. I will do whatever I want when I gamble, and when I lose, I will steal money. I will steal my step-parents' money. I will do all kinds of stupid stuff. I don't want to name all these things. But I realized that I was a sinner, and I need to be saved. You see, I mentioned this, right? Either your sins is being paid in hell forever and ever, or either your sins can be paid by the blood of Jesus Christ, who hung on the cross 2,000 over years ago to die for your sins and my sin. There, at the age of 15, 16, I realized that I was a sinner. I realized that I need to be saved. Unless you see yourself standing there with the shrinking crowd, full of hostility and hatred for the holy and innocent Lamb of God, you don't really understand the nature and the depth of your sin and the necessity of the cross. You don't, because you will continue to live your life the way you want. Just like the other thief that did not repent, because he didn't understand the severity of the sin they've ever committed. And he don't understand that the sin has consequence. So, number one, please realize that we are all sinners and in need of a savior. Secondly, just like the thief on the cross, he recognized that Jesus was that innocent man and Jesus was that perfect God, that Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. He recognized that he need to go to the Savior. He recognized that he need to be saved. You know, 2 weeks ago, I was in a severe pain. Severe to the point that I will rate the pain 8 out of 10. It was on a Wednesday night, just 2 weeks ago. And I was doing my discipleship group, and I was telling my disciples, and I'm sorry, I cannot continue this. I'm having a migraine, I'm having a headache, severe headache. My toothache is aching. They call all the dentists, then I went to the dentist, nearby dentist, and do an x-ray, and this is my x-ray. I thought that, wow, my teeth quite crooked, and so a bit weird. So nevertheless, the dentist asked me to go to see the dentist showed me the x-ray. And the dentist asked me this question, when was the last time you went for a dental? And I say, I don't know. I remember the last time I went to the dental was when I was primary 6. That's like 24 years ago. Please don't be like me. The reason why I was going through such pain is because I have not been going to a dentist for checkups for many, many, many years. Because I don't really know, right? I was ignorant, really, because of my upbringing. I was ignorant. I didn't even know that there's such practice of going to the dentist. When my wife went to the dentist for some cleaning and root canal, I laughed at him. I said, "That's so stupid. See, you're so weak," you know, kind of thing. Because I was really ignorant. And also because of the cost of a dentist during my upbringing. So I didn't really go. I was in severe pain. And that pain, and I have to deal with it, right? The doctor, the dentist told me, "Hey, you know what? You have a wisdom tooth that need to be extracted because that wisdom tooth is very near your nerve. That's why you're causing you to have such pain. And not just your wisdom tooth decay. I found another 5 decays in your mouth. You need to deal with it." What's the point of my stupid story? The point is this: you see, that decay of teeth is like sin. If you don't deal with it, it's going to come and bite you back. There is consequence. If I don't go to the dentist and do my clean my teeth regularly, there will be consequence. I realized that point. The doctor asked me, do you want to be treated? Do you want to do all the procedure for me to take out the wisdom tooth and feel all the decay and stuff?" And I have to make a decision then, right? And I have to do something about it. But unless you realize that there is a decay, I won't need to go to a doctor. In a similar way, unless you realize that you are a sinner, you don't need to go to the Savior. My point is that you need to know that you're a sinner and you need to go to the doctor who is able to save you from your sin. You see, the Bible tells us God loves you and He died for your sins. Your sin has to be dealt with. How? By Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us, "But God demonstrated His love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for your sins and my sin. And on that cross, He bore our sins on the cross. He paid the price that we supposed to pay. We were supposed to pay for our sins. But Jesus Christ came to pay for your sins and my sins. He took the full wrath of God and poured upon His own body. There we can, so that we can be reconciled. There, so that we can have life, so that we can be saved from sin. It was not the nail that held Jesus to that wretched cross. It was this unqualified resolution out of love for His Father, God the Father, to do the Father's will. And it was out of His love for you and for me. You need to recognize that you have a problem. You need to recognize that Jesus is the one that can solve your sin problem because He loves you. And He loves you by sending His Son Jesus to die on the cross for you and for me. And the thief also recognized something. The thief recognized that it is not his own good works. Similarly, I want you guys to recognize that it is not because you are someone who is rich and you deserve to go to heaven to be with Jesus. It's not because you have been in church for many, many years because your parents are Christians or pastors or elders or deacons. There I am safe and secure. No, it's not because of your status. It's not because of your good works. The Bible tells us, "For by grace you have been saved through faith." Just like how the thief had faith in the Messiah and he was saved, today you need to have faith in Jesus. And you need to understand that this is not your own good works. It is a gift of God, not of a result of works, lest any man should boast. It's not your good works, my friend. It's really out of the mercy and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ that you can be saved. What a mercy it is that man's sin are forgiven by God. All this is of grace. We don't deserve. I don't deserve. That thief don't deserve salvation. But it was because of really the grace of God, he received all. He got everything. He got salvation. He got Christ. He's going to be with Jesus in heaven. And he's going to spend all eternity to know God. That's beautiful, isn't it? The voice of sin is loud, but the voice of forgiveness is louder. So come to Jesus. Recognize that Jesus is the Messiah, that He's going to come in. He can save you from your sin if you choose to. So not just that, we saw the thief repented, isn't it? And today you need to repent. You need to repent of your sin and turn to Jesus for salvation. Jesus answered them, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick, spiritually sick, I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." Today God is calling. If you are not yet a Christian this morning, and maybe you are looking for the truth, and you hear your Christian friends talk about this Jesus, you were once mocking, but now you have an appetite. God is working in your heart, and you know that somehow in your life, everything is pointing towards this Jesus, the Messiah, and you want to know more. God tells you, don't just know Him, come to Him, repent of your sin, turn from your wicked ways, and turn to Jesus for salvation. And the Bible tells us it is a gift. You know, when I went to the dentist, right, the doctor asked me this question, so what are you going to do? Now you know that you have a dental problem. You know that I can help you. So what are you going to do? You guess what I did? I said, I don't need that. It's okay. Of course not. I was in pain. I said, please help me. Help me to save my teeth so that I can preach and talk more in the near future, so that I can eat good food. And I have to repent. I have to turn from what I used to think of dentists being expensive and it's for the weak and kind of thing. I have to change my mind and say, hey, I need help. And I turn away and I turn to the dentist for help. And I think in a similar way, you need to turn to Jesus. And by the way, the dentist is very kind, right? He don't force me, hey, your teeth is super crooked and super, you need, and I'm going to fix you and going to drug you and then you're going to collapse and then I'm going to do every surgery. No, the dentist did not force me. He gave me a choice. And today, similarly, I think Jesus wants to give you a choice. God won't force you to become a Christian, to be converted. God gave you a choice. That's why the Bible tells us it is a free gift of God. It is free, paid by Jesus Christ on the cross. But it is free for you to receive. And you have to make a choice, right? Where someone gives you a gift, either you can say, no, thank you, and reject the gift, or you can say, and humbly say, I want to receive. I want this gift. And this gift, the Bible tells us, is eternal life in Jesus Christ, our Lord. All paid on the cross for you and for me. I have received that gift 20 over years ago. And many of you here, I believe that you have received that gift many years ago. But if you have not, what are you waiting for? Realize that you are a sinner and in need of a Savior. Recognize that Jesus is the one that can save you from your sin. No other person can save you. He was the perfect man that saved. He's the perfect man. And as a perfect man and perfect man, God man, only He has the power to forgive sin. And He paid that price on the cross by His own body. Without the remission of, without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness of sin. Jesus went on the cross to die for you and for me. You have to make a choice, right? For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever, any one of us who believes in Him, turn from your wicked way and turn to Jesus for salvation. The Bible tells us, you shall not perish but have everlasting life. That is the promise. And that's what that thief did 2,000 over years ago. And that's something that you can do this morning as well. Realize that you're a sinner and in need of a Savior. Recognize that Jesus is the one that can save, and turn to Him, repent, and turn to Him for salvation. What will be your response this morning? Will you be one that will continue to mock, just like the crowd, just like the Jewish leader, just like the Roman soldier, the passerby, and the other thief? What will be your response? Will you still continue in your unbelief, disbelief? Will you still continue to think that he's just a joke, he's a liar? Let me tell you something. He is the Lord of the whole universe. He wants to be your God, and He wants to have a relationship with you. Whoever who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Will you turn back from your sin and turn to Jesus for salvation? Let us bow with a word of prayer. Today we look at the story of that thief on the cross through his lens. And we realize that he was someone that was mocking to one that was asking God for mercy. How about you? Maybe some of you think that, hey, I know that Jesus Christ is the Messiah, is the Savior, is the God of the whole universe. But I will wait. I will wait until before I die. Just like the thief, right? Before he died, I will come to Jesus Christ. At my deathbed, I will believe in Jesus Christ. But what if it's too late? What if something happened to you along the way when you go home? What if some tragedy happened to you tomorrow? Don't wait until the deathbed. Today, the Bible says, today is the day of salvation. Today, if the Spirit of God is working in your heart and knocking in your door and asks you to turn back, repent, believe, why don't you do it today? I want to pray for you. I want to pray for not just the unchurched people here, but I want to pray for even the church people. And if you are here in church for the longest of time, and the story of salvation, and you have lost the joy of your salvation, you have lost that motivation to serve Him and to live for Him, remember the cross, why Jesus came to die for you and for me, so that you can have life, so that you can have life more abundantly. But for the non-believers in our midst, God wants to have a relationship with you, and sin separates you from the love of God. Sin separates you from God, and in order to be reconciled, you need to come to Jesus. Believe in Him, turn from your wicked ways, and repent, and turn to Jesus for salvation. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. God, we thank You for this time. Thank You for Your word. Thank You for allowing us to see through the lens of that thief how he came to faith. And today we remember how we came to faith and remember those that have not come to faith. God, will You work in a way that no one can? God, You love us. You died on the cross for us. It's really out of Your love and mercy that You save us. So we commit every soul in this room unto Your hands, that You work and You rule and You reign. We thank You. We love You. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And we thank God for the message of the cross. Thank God for Pastor Rife just delivering the word to us. Let's respond with this song that he has chosen to respond. And in this song, it takes us through the scene where Christ goes towards the cross, how He hung on the cross and how He died. But the last verse reminds us of the good news that He is not dead, but He is risen. So let's respond to this song and sing together as we continue in worship. Thank you. see him there.
See him there upon the hill, hear the scorn and laughter. Silent as a lamb he waits, praying to the Father. See the King who made the sun and the moon and shining stars. Let the soldiers hold and nail him down so that he could say,
to continue with the communion.
At this point of our worship, we'll commemorate the Lord's death by taking the Holy Communion. Now, in this church, all those who have personally trusted Jesus as their Savior and who have publicly confessed this by baptism may take of this Lord's Supper. Now, if you have not taken the elements, can you raise your hand now so the ushers could pass it, the elements to you? Yeah. Just Now, the bread and the cup represent the body and blood of Jesus. Now, Pastor Yufei, focus on the thief. Someone here. But really, at this point, we're going to focus on Christ. Now, the bread signifies his body that was broken for us. Now, what was described by the verses, by the graphics, by Pastor Yufei, spoke of what we could see. The spitting, the whipping, the mocking, the nailing, the awful sight. But let me tell you, that's not the real suffering of Jesus. That is just a little introduction. The Bible tells us that Christ hung on the cross for 6 hours. The first 3 hours could be seen, and that's why we have graphic scenes. We can understand pain, we can understand mocking, we can understand spitting, we can understand whipping, we can understand nailing. But the Bible also tells us that at noon, the sun was darkened. And for the brightest part of the day, from noon to 3 p.m., it was totally dark. No one could see a thing, and no one could describe it, because it was totally dark and totally silent at that time. People panicked when the sun was dark at noon. It's not normal to see the sun dark at noon, and the eclipse, you have it dark for a few minutes. This is 3 hours. All the mockers were silent during these 3 hours. Personally, I think they trembled. They knew something was happening. They knew God was angry. They thought God was angry with them. And then they heard a cry from the cross. Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit. Father, why hast thou forsaken me? Now, I want you to understand this. When they whipped him, he didn't say a word. He never said, ouch. When they nailed him, he didn't say, ow. Not a whisper. But when that darkness came, he screamed from the cross. I hope you understand. The real suffering of Jesus was not at the hands of man. Because one day, if we don't receive Jesus as Savior, we will receive not Roman whipping, not Roman nails, we'll receive the judgment of God in a place called hell. And the Bible says it's a place of darkness. It's a place of anguish. You know, men will say, I'd rather go to hell than drink my beer with my buddies. You won't have time to drink beer with your buddies because it's dark. You'll only have screaming and yelling in that time. And so the real suffering of Jesus, as you take the bread, remember, it's not the Romans. He took your suffering and mine that you and I deserve in hell for eternity. Concentrated in 3 hours. 3 hours, the concentration of hell was condensed. The hell that millions should suffer was concentrated on one person. That's the suffering of Jesus. So now as we take this bread, as you take this little piece of bread representing the suffering of Christ, the body of Christ that suffered, I hope you understand. It's not Roman whips. It's hellfire on the body of Christ, which he took for us. And I hope when we take this bread today and in the months to come, we realize what Jesus did for us and what our friends who don't know the gospel will go through for eternity. For eternity. The yells and screams of eternity forever will hang on all those who have not received Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for taking it for me. Let's have a word of prayer. Lord, we come with this very simple element, tiny piece of bread. We take it too often. We take it frivolously. We take it almost ritually. Today, Lord, as we crunch this bread between our teeth, we realize Christ was crushed, not by Romans, not by Jews, but Christ was crushed for our sins. At the hands of a judge who has seen every sin of ours, every evil that we have done, this God who saw it all, this holy God, we thought that we could do all those things, and nobody saw. We thought this world is not just. We can commit anything we like, and so be it. We can hide. No, one day it is appointed unto man once to die, and after that, the judgment. And we thank you, Lord, you took the judgment for us. And today we come to take this cup and this piece of bread to remember what you did for us, what you suffered for us in your body, and the precious blood you shed for us to show that you washed away all our sins. So, Lord, as we take this bread and this cup, may the love of God be seen so clearly. May we once again rejoice that you loved us so much, you took our place, not under Roman whips, not a nail or two, but our eternal judgment. Thank you, Lord. So God bless the taking of this bread and this cup today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us, as a body of believers, take the bread now and the cup, remembering what it signifies. Lord, we thank you so much for allowing us as your children to be reminded once again of the unspeakable, unimaginable love of God, of the unimaginable sufferings of Christ. Help us, God, today to be grateful for what you've done for us, and to be concerned for others, Lord, who have not yet received Jesus. Lord, we don't want to be selfishly thankful. We want, Lord, to be thankful and useful. So help all the people in Gospel Light to love you more, love others more, and share this amazing truth of what you did 2,000 years ago for us. Help us, God. May Gospel Light be truly Gospel Light. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you all for joining us today. Now, it's our way in our church that all newcomers are welcomed, and one of the ways we show our welcome is join us please at the newcomers corner. You can take the escalator down or the lift. There's a little corner there where all of you are invited, all newcomers, to join us. And thank God too, for those who are not newcomers, breakfast has been prepared for us. May God bless you. See you downstairs.